Welcome to the second meeting in 2023 of the Finance and Public Administration Committee. The first item on our agenda is to take evidence from the Minister for Public Finance, Planning and Community Wealth on the Land and Buildings Transaction Tax, additional amount, transactions relating to second homes, etc. Scotland Amendment Order 2022. Mr Arthur is joined today by Ewan Cameron Nielsen, Head of Fully Devolved Taxes Unit at the Scottish Government. I'd like to welcome you both to the meeting and advise that I own a flat which I rent out as per my register of interests. I invite Mr Arthur to make a short opening statement.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to the Committee. The Land and Buildings Transaction Tax, Additional Amount Transactions Relating to Second Homes, etc. Amendment Order 2022 provides for the increase to the LBTT ADS rate set out in the Scottish Budget on 15 December 2022. The order increases the rate of the additional dwelling supplement from 4 to 6%. This change is intended to protect opportunities for first-time buyers and home movers by further helping them compete with buy-to-let investors and second home owners. The change is also forecast to raise much-needed revenue at a time when public finances are under significant pressure. The SFC estimates that it will raise an additional £34 million in 2023-24. As you will be aware, the legislation provided for the rate increase to take effect the day after the Scottish Budget Statement on 16 December 2022. This near-immediate change was intended to prevent the possibility of forestalling, which would have both reduced its revenue impact next financial year and run counter to the policy intent. This near-immediate introduction was also intended to provide certainty for taxpayers, acknowledging that the legislation must be approved by the Scottish Parliament to remain in force. As with previous rate changes, the instrument does, however, include a transitional provision so that anyone who entered into a transaction prior to 16 December will not pay the increased rate. I welcome the evidence submitted by a range of organisations in response to the Committee's call for evidence, and I look forward to members' questions. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. And of course, I will begin questions and open up to colleagues around the table. We received a submission from COSLA and some local authorities who have some concerns in terms of the impact on local authority housing. So, for example, Clackmannanshire Council have said local authorities pay LBTT and ADS on the same basis as private sector developers and land speculators, and no additional grant is made available to meet the cost of this tax. But this is in contrast to the full exemption from both LBTT and ADS that is available to registered social landlords. So why is that exemption in place for registered social landlords but not local authorities?
As you'll be aware, Convener, as a committee, we're aware we carried out in the process of carrying out a review of ADS. I'll have more to say about that relatively soon. This was one of the issues that was considered as part of that. We are carefully considering the consultation responses, and on that specific issue I will have more to say in due course, but I'm not in a position at the moment to go into any further detail on what the outcome of the review will be, but it is an issue that was considered as part of that.
I can understand your position there, but it is somewhat disappointing in that local authorities are concerned that this is going to impact on them now. So, for example, Clackmannanshire, as you know, is the smallest mainland local authority. And yet it says the increase in ADS from 4% to 6% will add a further £50,000 to the cost of a house purchase programme this year and an estimated £204,000 in 2023-24, which is not insignificant, as I'm sure you can appreciate. And it says, goes on to talk about the unfairness of this, and says that this will put additional pressure on rents, obviously at a time high cost of living. So when are you likely to have this review? Because one of the concerns we have in this committee is that we have this, the Scottish Government often tells us that they're going to produce reviews or they're going to produce reforms, and the months pass by and we don't see them. I mean, to be fair, we get the same from the UK Government. But when are we going to have a potential change that would benefit the tenants and the local authorities?
We consulted as part of a broad review of ADS last year. We have been giving careful consideration. This is a complex area, and it's important to get the balance right. But in the near future, I will be intending to bring forward regulations for consultation. This will respond to a number of the areas that have been raised as part of the review process. And of course, this will be a matter for the committee I'm sure, to consider, and be more than happy to give further evidence once I'm in a position to publish what our intentions are. At this stage, we haven't finalised our decisions in that matter, so I don't want to get into a position of speculating what is going to be our response to the review ahead of that. But I would want to assure the committee that we'll be bringing forward these measures quite soon.
Okay, I mean, you know, COSLA and, for example, have said that, you know, this impacts on their ability to purchase properties, for example, empty properties, you know. So they feel that that's going to be detrimental to that at a time when we've pressure on housing. And they've said there's no obvious policy objective to achieve the current arrangements for the payment of LBTT and ADS by local authorities that justify the different treatment from them and their tenants to RSLs and their respective tenants, the additional costs involved. And the point COSLA is making to reinforce what individual local authorities are saying is that they're going to have to be setting rent soon for next year. So you're talking about a review and potentially taking decisions, but without any date for a decision. And it's quite clear that, therefore, that rents are going to have to be set without those without a decision being made by the Scottish Government. I mean, from my perspective, I still don't understand why there's a difference between RSLs and local authorities.
This is something that has been in place for a while, but I'm conscious that it is an issue that has been raised, and that is why it's something we have considered as part of the review. But you want to come in, Ewan?
Yeah, if you have the Minister. Yeah, so as perhaps convenient just to provide a bit more context on the genesis of this. Going back to the introduction of Land Buildings Transaction Tax, there were, different arrangements put in place, a specific RSL, Registered Social Landlord Relief, and reliefs that would have been relevant to local authorities at that time. So the planning obligations relief in the Act, where essentially local authorities acquire housing through Section 75 agreements. There are other reliefs in the legislation that would apply to local authorities. So in a sense, in terms of the difference that's then emerged in relation to the ADS, which councils and others have flagged, essentially, that relates to the fact that the RSL relief flows through, or the reliefs that are available to RSLs flow through from the original LBTT relief arrangements in a slightly different way than they would do for councils. And so on that basis, that the councils are flagging this difference in approach. So there isn't a specific ADS relief as such for RSLs in this context. It's more a reflection of the kind of overarching arrangements put in place at the time that the LBTT legislation was agreed.
I mean, it just seems to me as if when this was put in place, there wasn't really thought given to this anomaly. I mean, if both registered social landlords, one is run by a local authority and one by housing association, it just seems to me daft that it applies to one and not to the other. Okay, we'll move on from that. I mean, others may wish to look at that in greater depth. I mean, obviously we've received responses from the Scottish Association of Landlords and indeed the Scottish Property Federation and others. And what basically the Scottish Association of Landlords has said is that, the kind of theory behind this increase is, as you said in your opening statement, is it will make more houses available to first-time buyers. But what they've said is that most of the tenants that they actually have are not in a position to buy anyway, which is why they're in the private rented sector in the first place. And but what this will do is actually reduce the availability of properties in that sector, because it will act as a deterrent for people to actually invest in that sector. And what they've said is that the members' survey that they undertook last month revealed that 44% of landlords are planning to reduce their portfolio size in the next 5 years, and that around 10% of tenants in Scotland will be evicted over that period, so landlords can exit the sector by selling their properties with vacant possession. Now, if there's real issues in terms of the sector at this time, how is this going to help?
Well, I can't comment on the decisions any individual landlord would take. It's also important to recognise that ADS does not just apply in terms of relation to PRS. It can be for second homes, holiday homes as well. There's a clear policy intent behind this, which is to support first-time buyers, but also to raise much-needed revenue. And as I said in my opening remarks, ADS will raise additional revenue. It's forecast to raise £165 million in the coming financial year, and £34 million of that is an addition because of the changes that we have taken. So that is the context in which we take these decisions. But there's also a broader context which is going to impact upon the decisions the people operating in the private rented sector will take, not least the prevailing economic conditions. As I say, we take a balanced approach to our taxation policy, and there's a clear policy intent that has been in place for a significant period of time which underlies the decisions that we take on ADS.
Okay, would the Scottish Government give consideration to a couple of areas that have been suggested to make exemption for investment in empty and new build properties in order to try and increase the supply of housing stock, or properties are being purchased with a sitting tenant?
Well, with regards to any proposals for future changes, we obviously have just been in the process of undertaking a significant review of ADS, but we would understand that we would always keep our policies on tax and more generally under review. So I'm happy to hear suggestions going forward about any changes that should be made. All I would ask if these changes, these proposals rather, are made in a way that's consistent with our framework for tax.
Now, what do you consider would be is likely to be the behavioural impact on this? Because you've talked about the importance of the money that's going to be raised by this measure, an additional £34 million, but there are obviously the £34 million is not net. That's following behavioural change. So what's your view on the level of behavioural change? How do you feel that's going to impact this tax in future years?
Well, ultimately, the SFC have set out its position. Because of the changes that we have made, that is going to lead to a net increase of £34 million once behavioural change is factored in. More broadly, looking at the revenues forecast for the coming years, there's clearly a number of factors at play, most obviously prevailing economic conditions. We are in the process of going into an economic slowdown. We also have seen an increase in interest rates as well, which is naturally going to, you know, impact upon demand for properties and consequently the number of transactions affecting forecast revenue. But over the five-year horizon in the SFC forecast, we do see revenues picking up going forward.
I think the issue that's being made here is, I think everyone is aware of rising interest rates and the prevailing economic conditions, but I think the concerns from the market are being expressed is that the Scottish Government is actually not working to mitigate that, but is actually going in the opposite direction. So, for example, Savills have said that the accumulation of measures have reduced the supply of rented accommodation in Scotland, such that, for example, there's 29% fewer properties listed in 2022 than in 2016. So there's a kind of, it's starting to be a downward slope, and there doesn't seem to be any incentive to try and reverse that. So, for example, the Scottish Property Federation have said that following these measures the tax basically on a home priced at £188,000, the tax will now be £12,140 in Scotland, whereas it was before this was implemented £8,380, but it's £5,640 in England. So basically the tax in Scotland will be more than double in England, so that could in actual fact discourage investment in new property in Scotland.
Yeah, well, that would be specific to ADS that you're referring there, because for people, for home buyers, and the threshold is £145,000 to £175,000 for first-time buyers. It's also important to take into account the distinction between property prices in Scotland. As of October last year, I think in Scotland the average property price was about £195,000. In England it was £316,000. So there is a...
in the southeast. I think if you look at Preston and you look at a place like Huddersfield, you'll find that it's not anywhere near those prices.
Yeah, that might be a fair point, Convener, but there's also the reality is the stamp duties are as an England-wide tax. It doesn't have regional variation, just as LBGT is a Scotland-wide tax here.
Okay, so basically the contention is of the Scottish Government is that this money is important for investing in our health service and other frontline services, and you don't feel that there will be a detrimental effect on the housing sector, whether it's socially rented or private rented?
I think part of the point I would make is that we have had our devolved system of the LBGT in place for some time, and we've actually seen, certainly following the pandemic, a significant resilience and recovery within the housing market. Now, I appreciate as we move into this year in the wake of the economic headwinds that we're facing, and as you say as well, the wake of rising interest rates, the impact as well, obviously, of the mini budget leading to mortgage products being withdrawn. All of that is combined is going to have an impact. But I think when you look at the revenue we are raising, LBTT is a very strong performing tax, and again, forecast going forward to be a tax that provides a net gain once the BGA is factored in. So the decisions we take are balanced. They're there, as I say, to support first-time buyers, but also to raise revenue, and that is what they're doing.
I mean, lastly, some of the before I open out the session, lastly, you've talked about supporting first-time buyers. Where is the evidence that the additional dwelling supplement has actually helped first-time buyers and encouraged them into the market? Because although it may impact on second homes, I'm not aware of any evidence that suggests it's actually helped increase the number of people who are able to get onto the housing ladder in the first place.
Well, the policy intent is to allow first-time buyers to compete more effectively, and that is ultimately what the policy intent is, and I think it's axiomatic that when someone is a home mover or a first-time buyer, they are not going to be providing the conditions subject to ADS, whereas someone who is an investor or buying a second home or a holiday home or a buy-to-let property will be subject to the ADS. So just in terms of the actual tax liability, it does allow for first-time buyers and home movers to be able to compete more fairly and increases parity within the system. So that is a policy intent.
Basically, it doesn't actually lower the price of the house for these people. It just means that their rivals, if you like, are paying more, would pay more for the same house.
Well, by definition, that's what the policy would do.
Yeah. Okay, thanks. Okay, everyone is keen to ask questions. So the first person will be Michelle, to follow by Daniel.
Good morning. Just following on in a similar theme, and first of all, I must disclose, as per my register of interest, that I own some buy-to-let property and was previously a member of SAL, but not for some years. A lot of the questions I might have brought out have been picked up by the convener, but I want to explore a bit more your thinking around the kind of market. Now, as a statement of intent, I am not uncomfortable with the Scottish Government raising revenue through taxation, and I'm not uncomfortable with a longer trend of diminishing the PRS sector to private landlords and increasing social housing. That's not an issue for me, but I'm interested to explore what your calculations are in the long-term effect in the market and in the round, triggered by ADS, but as we've already explored, it falls into LBTT. So can you talk me through your risk assessment of this policy change, and in terms of what you see as the risks and to whom the probability of those risks occurring and the impact when they do? Because I want to understand a bit more about how you're making these policy decisions beyond raising revenue, which I'm entirely appreciative of.
Well, we take our tax policy decisions through the medium of our framework for tax, which we've previously discussed in front of the committee, and that recognises a number of functions that tax can play. Yes, revenue raising, economic stimulus, behavioural change, and also redistribution. And we try to, and we seek to implement tax policy changes in a way that is consistent with the six principles we set out, the four Adam Smith principles plus effectiveness engagement. And that in itself is to contribute towards our four strategic objectives. For example, maintaining stability of revenues, responding to societal shift, national outcomes, and a well-being economy. So that is a process by which we take all our decisions on tax. With LBTT, we had stability within the LBTT system for a number of years with the rates. There was obviously an increase in the nil threshold in response to the pandemic, which subsequently reverted to its previous position. The decision we're taking here with regards to the additional dwelling supplement is consistent with the long-standing policy intent, which I've already stated to the convener. Now, in terms of looking at what the impact of this is going to be, the SFC have provided forecasts, and they demonstrate that when we look at the net impact on the budget, in each year forecast going forward to 27-28, we are seeing a net increase, 256 next year, 219 the following year, 190, 175, 165. That is additional revenue we have because we are taking these policy decisions, both on thresholds for core LBTT across res and non-res,
also because of what we're doing in ADS as well. And that provides funding to help us meet a range of objectives, and including as part of that wellbeing economy, our strategic housing investment to support the social rented sector as well. So there's a, it can't be seen just simply in isolation. There's revenue raising as well, which of course is revenue that is, you know, ultimately going to be deployed in supporting local services and indeed our housing programme.
I mean, you make my point for me that it cannot be seen in isolation. I suppose what I'm trying to explore is your consideration of the housing market, where for a variety of reasons, it may well be that the supply for properties to rent is diminished. And there is anecdotal evidence of that already happening. And indeed, Professor Graeme Roy has pointed that out. It's not hitting yet, because actually that's bringing in income in terms of LBTT. But it can't be that far down the road until it's going to have an effect in the wider market that will disproportionately affect people who need to rent and continue to rent in terms of rent rises and people exiting the market. So I'll go back to my original question. Do you undertake a risk assessment of tax changes based on setting out the risk, the probability of it occurring, and the impact if it does? Do you do that kind of thing?
Well, part of any tax policy, we consider what the behavioural impacts are going to be, both in revenue and, as I said, with relation to the framework for tax, how it relates to our wider objectives as a government. It's important, obviously, to recognise that this is a transactional tax. It doesn't impact upon existing PRS. There's exemptions in place.
It does, because, and I'm not saying it's just this. We've seen a number of malignant activities that have, I mean, Section 24 of the 2015 finance bill from Westminster, some of the rent changes, and I'm not saying, I mean, I agreed with the actions that the Scottish Government have taken, because I recognise the restrictions they have and the ability to support people at a time of crisis. But looking at it from the other side of the fence, there is evidence that landlords are starting to leave the market, and that will absolutely have an impact on available supply and therefore rent. So, but going back to my point, can I assume therefore that in terms of the wider market, of which ADS is just part of it, that you don't undertake the type of risk assessment that I am questioning, i.e. determining the risk, the probability of it occurring, and the impact on the wider market? Can I assume that you don't look at it in that way, you don't do that?
We take it as consistent in terms of this policy supports our broader policy on housing 2040. So that is already set out government policy, and all of our course of decisions are taken in tax with regards to wider considerations that are in government policy. So this is consistent and aligned with our broader strategic objectives. With regards to support for the PRS, I'll ask you to come in about the exemption for six or more purchases.
So I have to be covering that. So yes, so there is, in terms of the larger scale private rented sector, so there is an exemption from the LBTT additional dwelling supplement where six or more properties are acquired in a single transaction, which has been taken up. And in terms of the Scottish Government's policy narrative, is very much about supporting the larger scale private rented sector. So that's obviously going alongside the overall kind of position in terms of the PRS.
Okay, and just to finish off on this point now, I appreciate I'm straying into territory that's not yours, and there's a lot of work going on in housing, but can I impress upon you that as this is being thought about within the Scottish Government, that people look across the piece at a variety of stakeholders, and also critically look at the housing market as a market? And I'm not saying I agree with all of this, and I am very supportive of what the Scottish Government is trying to achieve, but there has to be an assessment of the effects, behavioural effects and so on. And thus far, I haven't been convinced there's a recognition of that, and I certainly haven't seen any data that would support that in terms of risk. So, thank you, Camira.
You, Daniel, to follow by Liz.
I mean, again, I'll be following on similar themes. I mean, ultimately, housing supply is a significant issue. We're still in a process of recovery. The number of completions last year in Scotland was around 15,000, below peak of, I think, or not peak, sorry, pre-COVID levels, around 22,000 housing completions in Scotland, which again in turn were still significantly below pre-2008 levels. So that, to my mind, that's the context. And the contention from Scottish Property Federation and others is that this will remove investment from housing. Now, I just wonder what evidence you have seen as to whether or not actually buy-to-let does result in direct investment in housing stock, or to what extent it actually just shifts existing housing stock between tenures. I mean, is that something the Scottish Government has looked at, is actually where that investment actually goes? Is it existing housing stock, or to what extent does it actually create new housing stock?
I think the first point is, I agree with you entirely in the need to recognise the broader context in which housing operates within and what determines demand and supply, and clearly the impact of what happened in 2008, the pandemic with the associated challenges around supply chains, the cost crisis and inflation, and indeed the challenges around recruitment and retention within the construction sector all have a part to play. And this is something that I'm very alive to following the Parliament's consideration of MPF4s. We cannot just look at any one aspect of government policy, whether it be planning or taxation, as being a determining factor. There's broader macroeconomic elements to this, and I think that's essential that we consider within that context. I think the point I would come to with regards to looking at the impact, to take the example of revenue, is what the SFC have forecast in terms of what would have been lost in core LBTT due to behavioural change. 50% recovery is anticipated, 75% beyond that. So there is, for example, from the SFC forecasts, the implication that transactions which were lost to ADS will be made up for over time through first-time buyers and home movers as well. I don't know if there's any point you would want to clarify in that, Ewan.
No, that's a reflection of the Fiscal Commission's view on that, yeah.
I mean, I guess the point I'm making is actually more fundamental, because that's behavioural impacts, that's to do with direct tax receipts. And I think that the point that, and it really follows on from what Michelle Thompson was just asking, is, I mean, she was asking about the assessment of the overall market. I guess what I'm asking is really this, is that, has the Scottish Government undertaken not just an assessment of these incremental marginal changes on the overall property supply, but actually a more fundamental sort of economic modelling, actually as to what, the investment in housing stock, where does it come from, and to what extent does buy-to-let? And let me be very clear, I am somewhat cynical about the contribution that buy-to-let makes to this. My view is that it largely shifts existing housing stock between tenures and doesn't necessarily contribute to that. But by the same token, I would quite like the Scottish Government to reassure me that it's undertaken that kind of economic modelling and it has a view, because ultimately we need investment in housing stock, and that has to be the bottom line that we view all of these measures. So has that economic modelling been undertaken? Is that something it will undertake as part of its review of LBTT?
In terms of our decisions around tax, we're taking them around as part of the overall budget process, and that's within the context of the government's existing policy commitments. Now, there are clear commitments around housing, particularly around the supply of affordable housing. The policies that we take overall with residential LBTT reflect the characteristics of the Scottish property market, which touched on earlier with regards to average house prices. So yes, we do take account of broader economic factors, and I say decisions are taken in a way that is consistent with the policy objectives in other areas, because decisions around tax, as much as can be, as a clear focus on revenue raising, we are not taking in isolation, which is why we said at the outset that key part of the intent behind the ADS, as has been the case since it was introduced, is to provide that support for first-time buyers.
It strikes me, if I'm sort of looking at the arguments being made by the sector, that they're claiming in broad terms that investment will be reduced. What I would observe is that they're unable to actually identify how many dwellings they're actually creating through that investment, nor are they actually able to give a figure to the level of investment in terms of into the existing properties. Because it strikes me, if you're going to invest, you're either creating new properties or you're upgrading existing properties. And I would also observe on the Scottish Household Conditions Survey that private rented sector has kind of the highest levels of defects and repairs being required. It's around 65% as compared to just below 50% for owner-occupied and just above 50% for social rented sector. So, I mean, again, is this something that the Scottish Government takes a view of as to actually how it can encourage not just investment in new dwellings, but actually investment in existing? And does that form part of its assessment of taxation policy? And indeed, are there ways that we could encourage investing in housing stock, you know, especially thinking about things like net zero?
There's, if you forgive me, Mr. Interman, much that you're touching on there that goes beyond my particular specific portfolio responsibilities and middle line more with Ms. Robson and Mr. Harvey. However, touching on the specific points you made around tax and investment more generally within finance and economy, yes, or as I risk of, I don't want to repeat myself, but of course our tax policy decisions are taken within the context of the budget cycle, the policy cycle, and our strategic objectives as a government. They are not taken in isolation, and there's a clear policy intent behind ADS, which we are all familiar with and understand, which is around that support for first-time buyers. So beyond that, and if there's any specific points you want me to touch on.
In a sense, forgive me, Minister, I mean, and they're not here to answer for themselves, but it strikes me, I'm just trying to probe the arguments, and if people are going to argue that they are creating investment, they need to say how and where and being point to it. And as much as I'm saying the government, I would like to undertake some economic modelling, I would say to the sector, they need to be a bit more specific and either actually be able to point to the investment in new dwellings or critically the investment in existing dwellings. And the statistics, especially in terms of the state of repair, don't tend to, I think, argue in their favour, is really the broad point I was trying to make. And I just wonder if you might share that point of view.
I think the government's position, particularly on the work we're doing for new rights and deal for tenants, is something that is, I think, consistent with your analysis and critique, Mr. Johnson.
I'll leave it there.
Thank you. Lister followed by Ross.
Thank you. Minister, I understand the need to raise revenue, particularly in these difficult economic circumstances, and I also understand that you believe that this policy has one principle behind it to help first-time buyers, and I may not agree with that, but I understand your context for this. But I also agree with the concerns that have been raised by the convener, by Michelle Thompson and by Daniel Johnson, who are making it clear that we don't really have terribly much evidence when it comes to the behavioural change, because there is an expectation, even from the Scottish Fiscal Commission, that there will be some behavioural change. And I think Michelle Thompson is quite right in suggesting to you that to be absolutely clear that the Scottish Government is on the right track with this, we would need some evidence on that behavioural change. And you've said that this has to be put in the context of macroeconomics. That's true. And one of the contexts of that macroeconomics just now is that the Scottish working population is not as good in size in relation to the total population that we would like for improving productivity and whatever. To what extent are you comfortable that the policy effects of this tax change will not have a detrimental effect on the mobility of the working population because of the difficulties about housing stock? And specifically, can I ask about rural populations where we have got pretty serious issues with housing? Are you convinced that this won't have a detrimental effect?
Okay, thank you very much, Ms. I'm very conscious as in answering these questions as Planning Minister not to start straying into that territory as well, because it's something that, as you can imagine, has occupied a huge amount of my considerations in recent weeks and months, and there's a lot there which speaks to the specific points that you raise around provision of housing and rural repopulation as well. But sticking to my public finance remit for purposes of this committee session, so the policy lead on in housing sits in a different portfolio. So clearly, the ministers in that place are best placed to articulate what the aims and objectives are, but fundamentally about enhancing and protecting the rights of tenants, ensuring that everyone in Scotland has access to a warm, safe home, and also including the availability of affordable homes are key priorities. And we reckon, and beyond that is a point I think you recognise as well, is that there are a significant number of factors which impact upon that, many of which are out with our control. And I recognise the point that it can be quite difficult to disaggregate what the various factors are. But having said that, that should not stop us from endeavouring to understand to the fullest possible extent what impact our tax policy decisions take. Now, we are obviously consistent in terms of our policy position that we want to ensure, we want to increase productivity in Scotland, we want to grow the number of high-skilled, high-paying jobs. We recognise that labour mobility is going to be an important part of that. We recognise that in the context of our ambitions around a just transition to a green economy. That is something that is going to be particularly impactful and particularly significant for our rural populations and rural communities as well. So these inform a range of policy decisions that we take in areas such as planning, in areas such as specifically our policy around housing and tenants, and yes, within our policy on taxation. And I would note that what we have for our residential LBTT rates, other than ADS, we have maintained them as we have in previous years, reflecting the particular characteristics of the Scottish property market. And if we look at the data over the past 12 months, notwithstanding some of the challenges of tightening in the market we're seeing more recently as a consequence of changing economic conditions, we saw a strong recovery in LBTT revenues, including ADS, following on from the pandemic, which is suggesting that our policies on LBTT are effective in getting that balance right of raising revenue and doing so in a way that is consistent, and that the tax is hitting that particular spot where we generate that net gain above and beyond the BGA, and the tax is not at such an extent that it's having a negative behavioural impact, which would obviously undermine the intent of raising revenue.
I accept that what you're saying in terms of it will raise revenue, that's clear from the evidence that we've had so far. But can I just come back to the point Michelle Thompson again asked about this very issue? The assessment of what is likely to happen in the housing market as a result of this particular change potentially is quite serious, and we've got obviously the evidence that's been presented to the committee. We've also got quite strong anecdotal evidence that people are withdrawing from that market. And my concern is to ask the Scottish Government as to what potential detrimental effects that removal of quite a number of landlords from the market having extra dwellings that can support the economy could have. And I come back to the point about the rural economy, because I think there is a real danger in some cases that if too much of that activity comes out of the market, it not only could have a damaging effect on the mobility of the working population and repopulating difficult areas for the rural economy, it could actually have quite considerable effect on tourism. And that, you know, we can't afford to have any detrimental effects on these aspects of the economy. So could I just ask the Minister again as to, you know, what evidence he's considering about these aspects of the economy? And my final point would be just to ask what discussions you've had with the Housing Minister over these likely effects.
On the latter point, obviously, it's part of the budget setting process. There are discussions that the Deputy First Minister on his capacity as Acting Finance Secretary will have with all colleagues across government into informing policy. So that goes without saying. In terms of what the impact would be, I would note the forecasts of the SFC for the coming years. Now, I appreciate there can be underneath these headline numbers of the revenue raised, there can be regional variations, and these are things that we will have to be alive to and consider carefully. But fundamentally, as much as there is a policy intent, and as I've referred to earlier, in supporting first-time buyers, there's also a policy intent in raising revenue. And we do have limited levers at our disposal within the Scottish Parliament. That is the nature of the devolution settlement. So we have to take a balanced approach. And First Minister, Deputy First Minister set out clearly what the government's strategic priorities are around the budget and tackling child poverty and reform of public services and in a just transition to a net zero economy. And these are ultimately going to have to be resourced through the revenue that we raise, a significant portion that we raise directly, as well as what comes through the block grant. So policy decisions, yes, they have to take account of the behavioural aspects and the individual applicability to other policy areas, but revenue raising in itself is of significant importance as well, because ultimately it is revenue that we have to raise to be able to deploy to support a lot of these other policy objectives. But I'm happy to give an undertaking to consider the points that have been made around how we can provide more information, more data on the behavioural impact that these tax policies have going forward. Clearly, we with LBTT, there is monthly updates from Revenue Scotland on performance, so it's something that we monitor very closely. I engage, you know, regularly with Revenue Scotland directly, in understanding the performance of the tax and some of the impacts that could be emerging. So it's something I say we keep under continuous review. And of course, as has happened previously in the context of the pandemic, when there is a need to adjust policy to reflect the circumstances, very exceptional circumstances granted, it is something that the government is able and, if required, willing to do.
Thank you. My final point, and to pick up the point that the convener raised, where he said that there were effectively some inconsistencies in this approach. And it was unfortunate that the timing of the reform to the additional dwelling supplement issue was at the same time as this, and that, you know, it's almost cart before the horse, that you're going to be looking at the reform process. Would it not have been better to do it the other way round?
I would have to concede, I think that is a perfectly fair and reasonable point to make. It had been our intention to have progressed further on the ADS review. However, given the complexity of the ADS review and the importance of being able to provide certainty and the need to get it right, we have taken a bit more time. But as I made reference to in my remarks earlier on to the convener, we will be bringing forward a response to the review shortly. And I look forward to the opportunities for further engagement with the committee on what we bring forward at that point.
Just for clarity, when is that likely?
It will be relatively soon. I think we're in the realm of weeks rather than months.
Okay, thank you.
I was going to ask what the word shortly meant myself, actually, so thanks for that. Ross, before by John.
Thanks, convener. Minister, you've talked a lot this morning about the wider policy intent around the additional dwelling supplement. You mentioned second and holiday homes specifically and distinctly from the private rental sector. Could you expand a little bit on what the government's policy intent is around second and holiday homes?
We recognise that second and holiday homes can play an important part in local economies, but we also recognise that they can present many challenges as well, particularly around population retention, affordability. So that is why we've had this approach, and it is also why through the joint working group to look at resourcing of local government, including around council tax, which has been established following the Bute House Agreement. We are looking at measures that we can provide in conjunction with COSLA that can enhance local authorities' ability to respond to these issues. For example, around the additional council tax supplement with regards to second homes.
Would you acknowledge that given we've got some particularly rural and coastal communities in Scotland where between a third and half, and I think there's a few instances where more than half of the properties are second or holiday homes and are therefore unoccupied most of the time, that once it has reached that proportion of a local community, the net impact on the community is negative? Any economic benefit during tourist season is more than outweighed by the fact that the community is in some cases largely vacant for most of the year.
I think, Mr Greer, the concerns you express are well made, and I know they're concerns shared by many, notwithstanding the positive impacts that holiday lets can provide. There clearly is a risk if there's a point of critical mass is reached that it can undermine the density of population required to sustain a community. One of the things that was much explored through the passage of NPF4 was the applicability of local living in 20-minute neighbourhoods in a rural context. That does present challenges and requires a bespoke response, but those challenges would be exacerbated in a situation where you have properties that are vacant. So these are, I think, well-made points, and while it is not a solution in itself, tax policy, whether it be through LBTT or indeed enhancing the powers available to local government and council tax, are important levers in addressing that.
On the point around council tax specifically, when government is evaluating the net impact on public finances of any tax change, or in this specific case around the increase to the additional dwelling supplement and the effect it has on the housing market, do you take into account, for example, that an owner-occupied house is contributing more through... there's no council tax relief there, for example. There's no NDR relief that there would be for a holiday, short-term wet business, etc. Is that the cumulative impact on public finances, both those that go to national and to local government, taken into account?
Yes, we do consider in the round, and I think that's it's also a very important point in understanding tax differentials between Scotland and the rest of the UK. It could be pointed to that there's lower thresholds that we touched on earlier for LBTT than there is for stamp duty. That is reflective of the Scottish property market, but we'd also recognise that in other areas, for example, council tax is lower in Scotland than it is south of the border, for example. So with NDR as a tax as well, we do have a lower poundage, meaning 95% of properties have a lower tax, non-residential properties have a lower tax liability than they would south of the border. So I agree with you entirely. It is important, both in the sense of looking at the sort of net revenue we're raising, the impact, and also in terms of any behavioural consequences because of a differential between Scotland and another part of the UK.
Thanks. And just finally, going back to the convener's original line of questioning around local authority exemptions versus other landlords for ADS. Well, touching not just on ADS, but actually on LBTT more widely, and the considerations that you've mentioned already specific to the ADS review, have housing cooperatives been considered there as a model of housing ownership that I presume we would want to encourage in Scotland, but which don't currently have any exemptions or relief to either LBTT or ADS specifically? Have they come under the purview of the ADS review, for example, or wider discussions about LBTT policy changes?
It's something that has been reflected on, but I'll ask you to correct me if I'm wrong, but I think they represent they're a very small part of the Scottish housing sector. I don't know if you want to...
At the moment, but obviously, if for example, the government's policy intent was to increase the proportion of the housing sector that was cooperatives, this may be a mechanism through which to do that.
Yeah, I'd maybe just ask you to come in at that point.
Yes, so certainly going back to the... apologies. Going back to the call for evidence in the ADS that was issued last year, or late 21, there were some questions in that around housing cooperatives, if I recall correctly, and views sought on whether there was a case for considering change in relation to that. So Scottish Government have received views on that and be considering that as part of the... But yeah, just to confirm your point, Minister, that, you know, as you say, it's a relatively small... but discussions have occurred, and there has been discussion with housing cooperatives about that.
As I say, it is something going back that we it's come up through the ADS review. But also just recognising, I think the word you used was minuscule. But as I say, we'll be in a position to set out our response to the ADS review relatively soon.
That's all from me, Convener.
Thank you. John, to be followed by Douglas.
Thank you. I think we've covered quite a lot of ground already, but we'll just to go over one or two points again. To take some figures as an example, I'm thinking, if a second home buyer or somebody who's intending buy to let has a budget of, say, 104,000. At present, that would be 100,000 for the actual property and 4,000 for tax. If we put this up to 6%, then that would mean that person only has 98,000 to pay for the property and 6,000 for tax, roughly. And therefore, the house price comes down by 2,000, and therefore, the competitors, i.e. the first-time buyers, will be advantaged because they will only have to beat a lower figure to get the property. So it seems obvious to me that this will benefit first-time buyers. Is my logic roughly correct?
Look, I would know that first-time buyers, but for any home mover who is not subject to ADS, the nil threshold goes to 145,000. For a first-time buyer, that's up to 175,000. So that is where the benefit is conferred. And for purposes of clarity, the rate now is 6% as effective as of, because of the provisional affirmative procedure, was effective at 6% from the 16th of December.
My example would have been better with higher figures, actually, where the tax did come in. But it's because I live in a property under 100,000, I tend to think of figures in that direction.
Just add the ADS, so it doesn't apply to properties below 40,000. I would also advise for anyone, there's a very excellent suite of LBTT calculators on the Revenue Scotland website.
Okay. But the point, I would still maintain, the point remains that it is clearly an advantage, surely, for first-time buyers if the competitors have less money to compete with them.
Yes, that is the policy intent, is to support first-time buyers. And I think the example you give illustrates the impact it would have. It for someone who is buying a second property as buy-to-let, the example you gave, £100,000, would be liable for, if they meet the criteria, would be liable for ADS, whereas a first-time buyer or a home mover who is not eligible for ADS would not be required to pay any LBTT because they're within that threshold. Indeed, for first-time buyers, as I said, it's up to £175,000.
And yes, I mean, I realise you don't want to stray beyond your own remit, but I mean, my understanding is a lot of constituents come to me who are in the private rented sector and who definitely do not want to be in the private rented sector. They're there because that's the last resort for them. They can't get a RSL house and they can't afford to buy. So, I mean, it seems to me that anything that moves the balance, even if it's only 2%, a little bit, towards the first-time buyer and away from the private rented sector, you know, for my constituents, that has to be a good thing.
Well, I think as members of the committee have recognised, the private rented sector plays an important role in providing flexibility for many, many people. But we would also recognise that there are many people who are renting who would much prefer to be in a position to own their own property. So that is what the intent of this policy is designed to support.
Okay, thank you. Now, on another angle, that one or two of the people who responded to us, and we'd asked them where should the money come from otherwise to make up the difference, was it 34 million, I think? And they broadly said, that's nothing to do with us. How would you respond to somebody like that?
Well, I recognise that organisations representing stakeholders have a primary responsibility to advocate for their stakeholders. But in Parliament, in terms of setting budgets, and certainly as a government, we have a responsibility to look at things in the round. And while there's a clear policy intent around supporting first-time buyers, there's also a policy intent of generating revenue. And we all recognise the significant challenges that public finances face currently and going forward. So I recognise, as I say, that it's entirely for organisations representing particular sectors and groups to advocate on their behalf. But for government, we have to consider things in the round and how that's going to impact upon all sectors and all people in Scotland.
Thanks, Convener.
Thank you.
And Douglas.
Thank you, Convener. Minister, I heard what you said about, trying to encourage more first-time buyers. So is it your policy intention to try and kill off the private rental sector. But so do you accept that not everyone wants to buy or has the ability to buy, and not everyone has access to the social rented market?
Yes, that's the point I made to Mr. Mason. As I recognise that the PRS plays an important role for many people. We want to see a range of tenures available. But we do have a challenge. Many individuals do face a challenge in buying their first property, or indeed moving from one property to another to reflect a change in circumstances. So the policy intent behind what we do with ADS is to support first-time buyers.
But is the best way to support first-time buyers not to build more houses? And as we've heard from local authorities, this policy change may actually reduce the amount of investment that local authorities make on housing and actually make the housing crisis worse than it actually is.
On the point with regards to local authorities, as I touched on earlier, we're giving very careful consideration to the issues that have been raised through the ADS review and have been in a position to say what our response is, as I've conveyed to the committee in several weeks' time. But more broadly, just recognise, as I would reiterate the point I made, that there's a role for the private sector, private rented sector to play. But there's a number of factors that will determine the supply of housing. We've touched upon this early, many of which are macroeconomic factors out with the control of this Parliament, or indeed any one single individual government, whether that be consequence of the supply chain challenges that we face, cost inflation and raw materials, issues around recruitment and retention within the construction sector, and of course the availability of financial products and following the mini budget and indeed the rising interest rates, they all come to bear to have an impact. So it's important, I think, in recognising the role of tax in terms of shaping supply and demand within the housing, it can't be seen in isolation. It sits within a much broader set of factors. Broad's a set of factors which I would suggest are significantly more impactful.
We've got to look at the factors that we have in front of ourselves today. And what we're seeing is this rise from 4 to 6%. We're being told by local authorities it is going to have an impact on the investment they make. And that is a direct consequence of the policy decision that you are taking. So is there nothing that can be put in place to try and mitigate that for our local councils?
I'm conscious of the committee's considerable interest in this area, and I will repeat myself again and say I appreciate strongly the concerns that have been expressed by local government. This is something we're giving careful consideration to as part of the ADS review, and I will be in a position to set out what the government's response is to that view in the near future.
But so surely then you must concede that it would have been much better to have that review before such a substantial change has been made to this policy?
I made reference to in my answer to Liz Smith that this was a review that was initiated in the early part of last year, but given the complexity of it and in recognition of many of the issues that were raised as part of that review, we're giving very careful consideration to it. As I say, we will be bringing forward a response to that review shortly, which will cover a number of areas that have been raised and I know are of concern to members across the Parliament.
So let's move on to a slightly different subject. So, you know, 2 months ago, Glasgow University put out a statement saying top university tells students to drop out if they can't find themselves somewhere to live. Now, will this change make that better or worse for the coming year?
I'm not familiar with the statement that was issued by the University of Glasgow, the broader context, so I can't comment on that. What I can say specifically is this is a transactional tax. It doesn't impact upon existing properties. It's about future acquisitions. And as Ewan said earlier, there are provisions in place in terms of supporting the private rented sector where there's an acquisition of six or more properties in a single transaction.
But Minister, surely you should be aware of the issues that are in the housing market just now because of the lack of supply. You know, a housing crisis described as unprecedented by letting agents has seen students unable to find accommodation this year, with the university recommended dropping out if housing cannot be found. So it's back to the point that Michelle Thompson made. Surely there should be some risk assessment made on the policy changes that are being brought forward here, so we don't have damage to our university sector by telling students to leave? And what impact is that going to have on the Scottish economy?
Well, my point, Mr. Lumsden, is I'm not responding comments that made when I've not had an opportunity to study the comments in detail and see the full context. The reality is that we do face a challenge in terms of providing within housing. That is something that is recognised, and we are taking action across a range of areas in government to do that. But the challenge and the proximate cause of the challenge are not solely down to specific policy decisions that any one government in any place can take. They are being influenced by a series of much broader factors, not least the fact we have just come out of a global pandemic. We are seeing significant cost inflation as a result of the broader macroeconomic challenges that we've been facing. And there's not going to be one single set of policies or suite of interventions that can address that. But the policies that we have taken around LBTT are demonstrably raising revenue. We have had a buoyant property market in Scotland. We have seen significant revenue raised through LBTT over the past year, above and beyond the corresponding block grant adjustment. And so in terms of the levels of transactions and the revenue raised, it demonstrates to me, and I think any fair and impartial observer would say, that this is a policy that is delivering on its objective of raising revenue, and that is revenue which is used to support vital public services, including supporting the delivering of homes and the services that communities require.
You're looking at the revenue raised by this tax, but you're not looking at the impact of this change. And we've seen it. If you look, people are telling us, all the views are telling us, it's going to have an impact on the private rental sector. And you've made no analysis of the damage that's going to cause to the Scottish economy.
The position is that we are seeking to support first-time buyers and people to be able to buy their own home. Clearly, there is...
Minister, if I'm a student, I don't want to buy a home. I'm only going to be there for 2 years, maybe three. So what do you tell those students that can't find a home and been told to leave their course or maybe move to England instead, if it's an international student, because they can't find anywhere to rent? What good is that doing to the Scottish economy?
I think there's clearly going to be a number of factors at play, but to suggest that that is down to a policy decision to increase ADS from 4% to 6%, I don't think to suggest that as a sole factor is credible. But there's clearly a range of factors that are impacting upon the supply of housing. And these factors, most of them, the majority of them, which are having the most significant impact, are factors out with our collective control.
Minister, I'm not saying it's a sole factor. I was asking, is this policy going to make that situation better or worse for the coming year?
What this policy is doing, it is supporting the raising of vital revenue, which provides a range of suites and a range of services and supports for our communities. Revenue that not least of all ensures that Scottish students are not having to go and rack up £9,000 a year on tuition fees. So that is the reality of the decisions that we take to ensure that we can maintain our social contract. And the way in which we do that is by having a progressive tax system. We have those progressive values are reflected in what we do in LBTT. And it's a tax that is working because it is delivering additional revenue above and beyond the block grant adjustment, which allows us in Scotland to offer a broader range of services and support than would be available otherwise.
Raise more of the ADS tax, but you don't care about the damage to the general economy due to students being driven away from Scotland because there is no private rental accommodation.
Well, again, Mr. Lumsden, you're drawing a direct link between that and completely ignoring the broader macroeconomic factors at play.
Have you made a risk assessment on what the damage is going to be to our universities?
We consider our policy decisions in the round. There are a number of factors that will determine the supply and availability of housing. To suggest that the sole factor is going to be ADS, I just simply do not think...
It's the sole factor. I'm asking, is this going to make it better or worse?
We are in a position, what we're seeking to do is to raise revenue, provide support for first-time buyers. There will be a number of factors that will, you know, impact upon the individual decisions that individual landlords take. And ADS may or may not be a factor in that. That is not for me to comment on, but clearly broader macroeconomic factors are going to be most impactful in determining the supply and availability of housing and, indeed, I think, the investment decisions that are taken.
Okay, I don't feel I'm getting anywhere there, Minister, so I'll ask one further question. You said earlier you welcome the views that have been given to the committee on this change. But you've ignored them all, really, haven't you?
Not at all. I've listened carefully and I've sought to respond to them in the context. I welcome the views that all stakeholders make and the time that they take to go and share their views and their expertise with Parliament. In government, we have to take a balanced set of decisions. And the consequence of not taking this decision on ADS would be less revenue at a time when we are facing significant challenges right across the public sector. So we have to take decisions in the round, and that is the approach that we have taken with regards to LBTT, as we have taken with all our tax decisions, consistent with the policies, principles and objectives set out in our framework for tax.
But none of the views that were submitted, you know, nothing has really changed your mind. So if I'm one of these organisations, I would be asking myself, why bother?
We consider a range of views and a range of opinions, and they will be balanced against a range of views and opinions from other organisations. That is part of the process of deliberating on public policy. Yes, particular taxes can have particular impacts, but on particular sectors or individuals or organisations who are liable for that tax. But the revenues raised also have an impact on the people who benefit from the public services. Decisions have to be taken in the round. We can't be in a silo just focusing on one aspect or one implication. They have to be taken in the round. And the context in which we find ourselves right now is a cost of living crisis where our public services are facing unprecedented pressure. And it is an absolute imperative, and I say a moral responsibility, to ensure we are properly resourcing our public services, which means taking proportionate, fair and balanced decisions with regards to how we utilise the tax levers at our disposal.
You mentioned supporting local services, but we're actually penalising local authorities. But I don't want to go over that again. But all the views that's been, you know, given to committee, we've heard reduced investment by local authorities, it'll drive private individuals out of the market, a reduction in the properties to rent, concerns changes made before the review. But you're ploughing ahead anyway, aren't you, Minister?
Well, what I'm conscious of is that SFC have forecast that we will continue to see significant revenue raised by additional dwelling supplements. So activity in the property market that is liable to the additional dwelling supplement is forecast to take place, and not just next year, but in successive years. And we are forecast to see from 25-26 a growth in ADS. So there's a broader context in which this has to be considered. And one aspect of it is forecast growth in LBTT overall and over the five-year period within ADS specifically.
I don't dispute that, you know, the figures show that there will be an increase in revenue, but I just feel that there's been no assessment done, as Michelle Thompson had said earlier, on the wider impacts on things like universities and to the damage that will cause to our economy. So I'll leave it there.
Okay, thank you. There's a couple of points I just want to follow up on, following the discussion. First of all, in terms of the local government, how much of the £34 million will be raised from local authorities?
I don't have that figure in front of me, but I'm happy to go back and, if it is a means of providing any greater detail at a granular level, to come back to the committee on that.
That would be very helpful. The other thing is, I think what seems to have come out of today's discussion is that, you know, the additional dwelling supplement appears to be a bit of a blunt instrument, so there are a lot of really good aspects to it. John Mason's point, I think, was an interesting one, because the 6% I don't think will not just make more competitive in terms of first-time buyers, but it will probably deter a number of people from the buy-to-let sector from entering the market in the first place, and that could reduce upward pressure on prices. So that could be a significant positive gain from this policy. Also, if it deters people from buying second homes in our rural areas, I mean, some islands in Scotland, for example, you know, well over 50%. I mean, I was in Colonsay a couple of years ago, and I think there's 108 people live there, and there's only two children in the school because it's been bought by retirees, you know, second homes. But some of them aren't second homes. Some of them are actually living in them, so they're not really. So that's another. And yes, it's a housing issue rather than a finance issue, but they don't apply. But one of the things with the ADS is I think it can be a bit of a blunt instrument when it comes to people buying derelict houses or houses that are a wee bit run down in order to upgrade them and live in them. And I think that's another area where there should be further thought made to this. So I think, it's too broad an instrument, if you like. But I think it's got some really positive aspects to it, but also negative aspects, if you know what I mean. I think it's just it can act as both an incentive and a disincentive to the government's objectives, as I see it in broad terms. Okay, don't know if you want to add anything further, Minister, before we move on.
Only to say I'm very grateful for the committee's scrutiny, as always, Convener.
Well, I think, and I appreciate that I understand Douglas's frustration, the question he's asking, how this isn't going to impact on government policy, but I would hope that, you know, when you take decisions in the future, weeks, months and years, you will actually reflect on some of these when you're considering things as we move forward, particularly in terms of, for example, local government. Okay, right, let's move on to agenda item two. Subordinate legislation. So I want to again thank the Minister for his evidence, and we turn to formal consideration of the motion on the instrument. So I invite the Minister to speak to and move S6M 07288.
Formally moved.
Right, okay. So that motion is that the Finance and Public Administration Committee recommends that the Land and Buildings Transaction Tax, additional amount, transactions relating to second homes, etc., Scotland, Amendment Order 2022, SSI 2022/375, be approved. Do members have any further comments? Liz?
Thank you. I get the point about raising tax revenue. I understand that, and you know, I think it's incumbent upon all parliamentarians to recognise that that's very important. I do think in this instance, Minister, there are a lot of unintended consequences of the proposed legislation that I really don't think has been thought through. And therefore, I find it pretty difficult because I think these are very important to the future of Scotland. So I will be abstaining when it comes to the vote on that basis.
Okay, Daniel, to be followed by John.
Thank you, Convener. I'll be brief. I mean, I broadly agree with the ingoing rationale from the Scottish Government on this measure. However, just reflecting on the discussion that we've had, I think it is important that we are evidence-led. I think it's important that we undertake both, I think, specific analysis of the impact, but also actually the broader modelling, because we do need investment both in terms of increasing our housing stock, but improving existing housing stock. And I think while I might not necessarily agree with the full sentiments expressed in the previous debate, I do think we need to look at these things in the round. And I'm not convinced that I've heard that today, but I will be supporting the measures. But I would urge the Scottish Government to look at the broader impact so that we improve our housing stock, both in number and quality and affordability.
John?
When I was younger, it was almost assumed if you had a reasonably decent job that you would try and buy a flat and then perhaps buy a house later on and all that kind of thing. That was quite normal. And I'm afraid that has changed. And there are various reasons for that. But one is, especially in rural areas, as Ross Greer was pointing out, second homeowners, people from the cities, people from Glasgow going into Fife, all that kind of thing, can outbid local workers who are not on perhaps a great wage or salary. And then in the cities more, perhaps the problem is that young people cannot compete with people buying to let. So anything we can do to redress that balance, and I think this is only a small move, we're talking about 2%, not a big deal in many ways, but anything we can do to help these younger people who are struggling to get onto the housing ladder has got to be positive.
Okay, thank you for that, Ross. And then Douglas.
Thanks, Convener. I mean, the £34 million that this will raise is going to go towards public services that I think we all recognise are needed more than ever during a cost of living crisis. We shouldn't also lose sight of the fact that it will raise a small amount of money in the remainder of this financial year, which will be important in closing what is quite a challenging gap in our public finances. But I really want to associate myself with the comments that John Mason has just made, because there's also an issue of generational inequality here. For a lot of folk my age, a little bit older, a little bit younger, in previous generations, they would have been at the point, by now I'm 28, they would have been at the point where they would have been able to own their own home. That would have been the norm, as John Mason says. For so many of my friends, for so many of the folk that I went to school and my brief time at university with, that is not the case for a whole range of reasons. But the imbalance in the housing market that favours buy-to-let landlords is one of those reasons. And in a small way, this tax change goes towards beginning to redress that. It sits alongside, in my view, other measures such as the new powers being given to local authorities to regulate short-term lets. There's a range of other measures that we need to take, but as well as the primary consideration here, which is about raising public raising revenue for public services at a time we really need it, redressing that imbalance in power and the generational inequality in our housing market is a strong argument in favour of this change. This modest change, we could have gone far further. This change, I think, gets the balance right.
Yeah, I mean, just to second that myself, I mean, I bought my first flat when I was 21, and my children are 30, 26 and 24. One still lives at home and two rent because they simply can't afford the deposit that's required to actually buy property. So I do sympathise with that particular viewpoint. And I think that's having huge socio-economic impacts on Scotland. People will be able to even decide when to start a family, etc. All these kind of things that obviously follow on from that. Douglas?
Thank you, Convener. If this was just an increase in tax on second homes and even holiday homes, I'd be fully supportive of it. I do feel there's another piece to this, a piece that I was speaking about earlier, and that's students trying to rent accommodation. My son's just been through that quite lately, trying to rent a flat. And I know how difficult it is for many students. The market has shrunk considerably, and I think that this will make it even worse. You know, 34 million is, you know, it's obviously always great to have more revenue coming into the government to spend on local services. But I do have real concerns about the unintended consequences on the impact it's going to have to the wider Scottish economy. You know, I was trying to highlight, you know, students being told to leave their course, go somewhere else. You know, the amount of revenue that international students bring into this country is significant. And if we're driving them away to places in England, for example, then that's going to have a much bigger impact than the 34 million that's on the table. It does seem like there's almost a war on the private rental market in this country. And it's back to, you know, to get more people onto the housing market, more first-time buyers, the key is to build more houses. And I worry that this is going to have a negative impact on that going forward. Hopefully I'll be proved wrong, but I have real, real concerns.
OK, thank you very much for that. Anyone else wish to comment at this point? No. OK, so I now put the question on the motion. The question is that motion S6M07288B agreed. Are we all agreed? We are not agreed, therefore we will have a division and we'll call for a show of hands. All those in favour? Against? Abstain? Okay, the result is that five people have voted in favour and two members have abstained. Therefore, the motion is agreed to. So I'd like to thank the Minister once again. The committee will publish its report on this SSI in the next few days. That concludes the public part of today's meeting. The next item on our agenda, which will be discussed in private, is consideration of our work programme. So we'll now move into private session and I'll call a break until 10:55. Thank you.